Well, thank you. It is indeed a pleasure to be with you here in Tromsø. I'm just sorry it's just me. I know that my presence is appreciated, but this was going to be the big year. This was going to be the big year where the United States was going to demonstrate a presence. We were going to be here at Arctic Frontiers. We were going to be at the Arctic Encounter Symposium in London. There was going to be a half dozen members that were keyed in and focused on the Arctic. When was the last time you saw a half dozen senators bipartisan in the Arctic? Well, you haven't. So we were almost there, and then circumstances that were clearly beyond our control have intervened, and you know the rest of the story. Things are a bit of a mess right now, so Aina, you've extended the opportunity to explore a little of Tromsø. My plan was to be here for one day because I have to get back. I'm tempted to just spend the rest of the month here. Maybe they can figure it out without me, but we will see. It is so important that I am here with you as we speak about the shared interests of the Arctic nations, really the interest of the world at large in the Arctic as we speak. And it is so important for us all to understand the views of the United States towards the Arctic. Because as it's pointed out, we in the United States are one of the eight Arctic nations. But I will tell you that we certainly do not have the political presence that our geography would demand. And I think you see that, you mention it to me. It is very clear that from the U.S. perspective, there are so many that don't get it, are not engaged. Now, you mention the view of the map. You challenge people to turn the map on its head so people can get a real indication of the geostrategic importance of the Arctic and its dominance on our globe. Part of our problem in the United States, in this senator's view, is our maps. I'm sitting here looking to this and thinking, oh, this is a great view, kind of a classroom. You've got the chalkboard up there and classroom chairs. Maybe that wasn't the plan, but that's the way I looked at it as I was sitting here. And I was thinking, in most of the classrooms in the United States of America, when you have the U.S. up there for the children to see, it is the continental United States with the 48 states, Hawaii sitting over here off to the left, and usually Alaska's in a little box down off of the coast of Mexico somewhere. You laugh, but this is a true story. And so we are challenged. We are challenged from the beginning because we are remote and we are not connected to the rest of the states. But then when our own maps confuse people, confuse children, as to where we are and why we're even important at all. This is something that we've got a long ways to go. I spent a lot of time reminding my colleagues that we are an Arctic nation, and we're an Arctic nation because of Alaska. But then that too becomes confused. Well, maybe the Arctic is just Alaska and it's not the rest of the country. It must be a national interest. It must be a national priority. And this is where we have been challenged. Historically, the U.S. Arctic, Alaska, comes into perspective at times of crisis or strife. We were front and center shortly after the Second World War as the U.S. homeland was that point of view for the Japanese. and we were invaded on our homeland. And so it spurred the rest of the country towards action in terms of military infrastructure, in terms of a road that would connect us to the lower 48 states. It was that national incident that brought the eyes of the country and really the eyes of the world to the U.S. Arctic. And not too many years ago, 30 years ago now, the eyes of the country and the eyes of the world were again directed to Alaska's spaces when we had an environmental disaster, when the Exxon Valdez had a terrible tragedy with an oil spill there. We cannot be acting in a responsive way to calamity, and that's how we view the Arctic. We have to view the Arctic as our opportunity, as our challenge, and again, as our national priority. So as we think about where we are in a new administration, 2 years into the Trump administration, we all know that there are some views and perspectives with this administration that are very different from what we have seen from the Obama administration. This is to the consternation of some and to the appreciation by others, but that's a debate that I'm certainly not going to have up here. Maybe we can have on the panel. But what we're seeing now are national security interests and economic development. These are the new central tenets in this administration. The previous administration viewed the Arctic more through the lens of climate change. And I have suggested that climate change is absolutely, absolutely one lens that we must look at. But we must never forget the other aspects of the Arctic, the people who live and work and raise their families there, the economic opportunities, the environmental opportunities and challenges. It is bigger than just one issue. And so we're at a different relationship, I think it's fair to say, between the state of Alaska right now and the Trump administration. There's probably greater emphasis on local priorities within the state than the previous Washington, D.C. driven directive. But I will say that when it comes to a policy direction at the federal level, there is clearly a void within this administration. You just look at where we are within the State Department as part of its streamlining. They've terminated most of the 70-plus special representative positions, including the special representative for the Arctic. So we have no key higher-level individual that you look to and say, that is the U.S. representative for the Arctic. On top of that, we're still waiting for key nominations, like the Assistant Secretary for Oceans and International Environment and Scientific Affairs at the State Department, which is the lead on international engagement. Our current Secretary of State simply has not been as engaged on Arctic issues as our previous secretaries were. Those are significant issues for us, because if we are not participating at those senior levels, if that U.S. presence is not felt, that political presence is not there, it is assumed that there is an absence of interest. I will suggest to you that it's not an entire absence of interest, that there are other ways that we are proceeding. Our senior Arctic official, other career staff are very busy behind the scenes. I know many of you are engaged with them. We're active at the Arctic Council meetings. We have U.S. leadership among the Council's working group. And certainly when it comes to our participation at international maritime forums led by or led by our U.S. Coast Guard, we certainly see that presence there as well. And I particularly thank our Coast Guard because I think they're leading at levels that are greatly, greatly appreciated. We've also seen several appointments from the administration of Alaskans to high-level departmental and agency positions. So we are putting ourselves in places where we can make that difference. We can help impact some of the domestic progress that positively impacts the U.S. Arctic policies. But having said all that, we must have high-level leadership for our nations to follow. So when there's an absence of that leadership within the administration, there is clearly a role, perhaps a heightened role in my view, for what we are able to do out of the Congress at the legislative level. So I've introduced an Arctic Policy Act. This is revised, updated, refreshed legislation. We introduced it late last Congress. We're introducing it again. But what we do is we codify the Arctic Executive Steering Committee. This was established during the Obama administration. We've changed it somewhat. But the original intent of that steering committee was to develop government-wide Arctic policies rather than leaving it to each individual agency, department. What we were seeing was very siloed approaches. And so it was difficult to know what is the Arctic policy. It seemed like every department had its own Arctic policy. So what we're intending to do is establish a more coordinated policy rather than settling for duplicative efforts that really are not time efficient or resource efficient or even worse, created conflict between agencies. So the steering committee was a good idea and one that we need to retain. We also name chair of the committee, this would be through Homeland Security, the director of the Office of Science and Technology Policy is the vice chair, so it reflects the strategic and scientific importance of the region. Equally important, in my view, is the forum that we allow for our indigenous peoples to be represented and have a seat at the table. We create an Arctic Advisory Committee to provide Alaskans and others that are engaged and interested in the Arctic with a seat at the table when it comes to designing and crafting so many of these Arctic policies. We establish regional tribal advisory groups to ensure that the indigenous populations, these are the people, you want to talk about smart Arctic. Smart Arctic comes from those who have lived in the Arctic for tens of thousands of years. And I say, you might not have a lot of PhDs out there, but you sure have many, many, many PhDs in Arctic living. This is where these smart policies come from. And from the ground up. So we're working to advance this legislation to again help address some of what I believe continues to be this Arctic void. Before I leave the podium here, and I know that this is perhaps somewhat pedantic, but we're gonna get to more engaged discussion here as we look forward to the panel. But I wanna recognize the efforts that are already underway at the subnational level to help further fill out some of the Arctic policy void. The Northern Forum, which includes 18 subnational and regional governments, has been around since 1974. They're helping to improve these transboundary cooperations. But over the past several years, what we've seen here, I think, has been very important. We've seen leaders from Alaska, from the Canadian territories, from Greenland. They've come together on a handful of different occasions to look at the possibility for greater regional cooperation and how that interaction can help then drive domestic Arctic policy in our respective national capitals. And we're seeing more and more interaction and engagement at that community level. At the Fairbanks Arctic Council Ministerial, we had 12 mayors from communities in Alaska, Canada, Finland, Iceland, Norway. We had the mayor of Tromsø, we're all gathered to raise issues of local concern, and they shared their challenges. But we really saw It was great engagement. And by gathering across political boundaries, these mayors really contributed substantive voices and views on the national and international discussions surrounding the Arctic. So I know that much of our discussion focuses on the national level, but we should also be supporting the input and seeking the input from the subnational levels as well. So again, thank you for the opportunity to be with you today. Thank you for the opportunity to share, to collaborate, to learn, to vent. We'll do a little bit of venting as well. But it's wonderful to be with you all again this morning. Thank you.